Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to continue this presentation on seismic aspects of dams, and I'm just discussing here or referring to some large dams in highly seismic regions. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Okay, I think I have mentioned that once, but for those who came later, the largest dam in the world is a natural dam, and it is Ussoy Landslide Dam in Tajikistan, which is 650 meters high, and it was created by a landslide, caused by landslide, which was triggered 110 years ago by a magnitude 7.3 earthquake. You see here, this is basically the dam crest, and this is a reservoir, and the reservoir has a depth of 600 meters, roughly, here near the dam. So this is by far the greatest dam which exists, and it was caused by earthquake. You see here a view from the lake. This is here where this big landslide occurred, about, I think, 2.5 billion cubic meters, a huge landslide. The biggest dam in the world, embankment dam, is a Nurek rockfill dam, and is 300 meters high. You have also very high dam, Viteri Dam, which is 160.5 meters, which has some similarity. Okay, it belongs to a former Soviet Union, and this is in a Pamir mountain range, which is known as an area of very high seismicity. You see here from the upstream face of Nurek Dam, looks like this, some intake tower. I mentioned it also, the largest arch dam for quite a few years, until about 6, 7 years ago, was the Inguri Arch Dam in Georgia, also in the former Soviet Union. Just like to mention here the special feature, some of the dams built in, let me say, former Soviet Union, have been some special ones, like Nurek. It has some inspection galleries, and I understand that there were some Russian consultants also involved in the Teri Dam, and there also some inspection galleries have been provided in the core. This dam here, Inguri Arch Dam, it has what you see here is a peripheral joint. I mentioned in the morning, in the first presentation, stress concentration. You have at the dam, let me say, foundation interface, you have stress concentrations, and by providing a peripheral joint, as shown in this case, you can, of course, eliminate this stress concentration, because you have already a crack. Basically, this joint is a crack, so therefore, you do not have a problem of stress concentrations. But there are only very few dams with these peripheral joints, which is a concept which was introduced by Italian arch dam engineers. It is called their pulvino, or peripheral joint. We see here, this is this concrete saddle, which is connected with the abutment, but by this peripheral joint, you can eliminate, as I said, the stress concentration, and in addition, by this concrete saddle, you can make a more or less symmetrical shape, or it allows you to make a symmetrical shape of a dam. And we know if you have a symmetrical shape of a dam, its seismic behavior is much better than if you would have a highly asymmetric monolithic dam, for example. Okay, so, but today I would say hardly anyone is building arch dams with this peripheral joint. Okay, this is in India. This is Dibang. It's a photo which I took. It's already 15 years ago when I was there, when I was involved. It is a Dibang River, and I just put this about 30 meters mark to show how much the water level is fluctuating within a year. Okay, other dam which I have shown, the Nilong Jhelum project in Kashmir, which is also located in a very highly seismic area. The peak ground acceleration of a safety evaluation earthquake at this site here, the headworks, is 1.25 G, very large. Typically, if you look in Indian dams, seismic hazards which have been estimated in the past for a few dams in the Himalayas were in the order of 0.3 G. But I think in a 0.3 G are also values we have in Switzerland, but in view of the high seismicity of the Himalayas, if you would use similar concepts like in Switzerland, you would get higher values than 0.3 G. Now let me say something about the seismic hazard. I just go very quickly through that. The seismic hazard, to repeat, I think it is an important issue, therefore I'm repeating it a couple of times, and I hope you will not forget it at the end of this training course, that the seismic hazard for large dam projects is a multi-hazard. It involves ground shaking, which is the main hazard concerned by most earthquake regulations and the codes. Number two, we can also have fault movements in the dam foundation. I discussed it last time, or discontinuities in the dam foundation near major faults, which can be activated, causing structural distortions. And if we have fault movements in concrete dams, this is more critical, actually, than ground shaking. Okay, so it is important that we check for that. We can have fault movements in a reservoir, which may cause some water waves, like in a tsunami, and they may also cause loss of the freeboard. But very important, I would say, in the mountainous regions, like here in the foothills of Himalayas or Western Ghats, I think where you have a lot of mountainous, a lot of hills, I would say a big hazard for these projects are mass movements. These mass movements, my observation is, it has been ignored basically in many places. We have really noticed that mass movements have caused more loss of lives, greater loss of lives. For example, in the epicentral region of the 2008 Wenchuan earthquake, than ground shaking. So mass movement has been underestimated up to now, and I must say it must be considered. And there could be other site-specific and project-specific hazards. I have shown it if we have hydraulic fill dams, old methods of construction or dams on sandy, silty material. You may have liquefaction, for example. And of course, concrete dams and embankment dams may be susceptible differently from different types of hazard. It is very important, I must say, please keep that in mind, that all these hazards are taken into account in the seismic design and safety assessment of dams. So do not only focus on ground shaking. I would say a typical case is this Fukushima nuclear plant catastrophe in Japan in 2011. I think most emphasis usually in a seismic design is doing very sophisticated dynamic analysis, and people have spent, I'm sure, a lot of effort in doing such dynamic analysis, but they may have underestimated the other effects, and that was, in that case, it was the tsunami which has flooded the emergency power supply, and therefore cooling was disruptive and causing this partial meltdown. So it is very important to really address all of them. Now, in among the engineers, I would say many people like to talk about peak ground acceleration, okay, the PGA. The peak ground acceleration, okay, it is a value, let me say, just to characterize very roughly the seismic hazard at the dam site. But it is not really relevant, let me say, for the seismic behavior of the dam. And this can be seen from this earthquake in Japan, Miyagi earthquake. It was basically not a big earthquake, magnitude 5.5. It has a foreshock and then main shock and aftershock. So the foreshock with a magnitude 5.5, you see that there are some seismic stations at some epicentral distance of about 4 to 8 kilometers. But this one here, Naruse, it peak ground acceleration of 2G was measured for a magnitude 5.5. We can say magnitude 5.5 earthquakes you can have everywhere in India, I must say. So if you would only focus on this peak value, if you are very close to the, let me say, epicenter or hypocenter is very shallow, then you can have very high peak ground acceleration. This is not on a rock, this is on soil. Also, when in a main shock is a magnitude 6.2, is also an event which I would say you can have everywhere in the Himalayas. In Switzerland, I think it is, could also be, some people also claim that it could be possible anywhere. This earthquake here at another site, 4 kilometers epicentral distance, gives 1.2 G vertical, and it gives 1.6 G horizontal. Then was another aftershock, magnitude 5.3. It's not big, you know, it gives 0.65 G. Okay, what I want to say here is, if you record the ground acceleration close to an earthquake fault, you can record very high accelerations, which are by far higher than any of the accelerations you have considered in the design of your dam. Because I mentioned typically in India, in recent years, I would say seismic hazard studies had resulted in some peak ground accelerations of about 0.3 or so G, which is many factors less than this. But the peak ground acceleration is not really the factor describing the dynamic behavior of the dam and does not describe the possible inelastic deformations of the dam, because if you have a 5.5 shock, the duration may only be 1 second. Also 6.2 may be just a few seconds. What is important for the damage on dams and on any structure is the duration of strong ground shaking. You need a number of load cycles in order to create some damage, which would be caused something similar like low cycle fatigue. Okay, so this is an extreme case, but I like to show to those people who believe very much on the peak ground acceleration. Otherwise, you know, you would have to design your dams for 2G. It is not realistic. Okay. But what has been measured, which is a list of dams in Japan, which have been subjected to a magnitude 8.3 earthquake, it's a very strong one, in 2003. And in Japan, there are a number of dams, over 400 equipped with strong motion instruments. And I just want to show here, there is a gravity dam, 140 meters high. In a previous presentation, I've shown Koina Dam, which is, I think, about 104 meters high. Just in this height category of about 100 meters, it was subjected to peak ground acceleration of 51 gal. One gal is 1 centimeters per second squared. So that means this would be 5% of G. And at the dam crest, then the peak ground acceleration you see is 677 gal. That means 0.67 roughly G. And but what I would like to draw your attention is what has been measured. Peak acceleration at the base is 5%, and at the crest it is 67%, which is a factor of 13. Okay, this is quite important. Please keep in mind that concrete dams, if they are excited, they will respond dynamically, and the dynamic response at the crest is much more severe than at the base. If you use a pseudostatic method, if you would design like that, you would basically assume that at the crest, the acceleration is also 51 gal. Pseudostatic method, do you not account for the dynamic characteristics of the dam? The dynamic characteristics of the dams are basically the mode shapes and the damping ratio. Damping ratio is very essential, giving this amplification factor of 13. Usually, if we have a stronger earthquake, still in gravity dam, we can estimate amplification factors in the order of maybe 5 to 7. Now, the other one I would like to draw your attention is a 120 meters high Rockville Dam, also in this 100 meter category. You see here for also weak acceleration, 0.05 G, 5% G at the base. We have on the dam crest 32% G, that gives an amplification factor of 6. So if you do not have a very strong earthquake, the amplification factor can be substantial. Similar, therefore, maybe the last I would like to show is this dam here, Nikkapu Dam, Rockville Dam. It has a stronger peak ground acceleration at the base, and at the crest it is only, let me say, about 1.8 times the peak ground acceleration. So it is not necessarily that you have factor 6, but if you do seismic analysis of embankment dams to strong ground shaking, you may still have amplification factors of 1.5 to 2. But for smaller shaking, smaller intensity, the damping actually also of the earth structures is smaller, therefore you have larger amplification factors. So what we can learn from this simple example is that in the concrete dams, we may have quite substantial amplification factors. Gravity dams, it can be We order 5 to 7. Arch stamps are not given here, but you can reach wear factors exceeding 10. And for embankment dams, the amplification from the base to the crest is in the order of about 1.5 to 2, maybe. But for smaller shaking, the amplification factor can be much larger. This is just as a rule of thumb. Also with the seismicity, this is from the 2004 Andaman Sea earthquake, which shows main shock. Okay, this is from the early days. It actually was a 9.1 magnitude. At that time, the estimate was slightly less. But what is shown here, days after that earthquake, the maximum magnitude observed. There are plenty of aftershocks. You see the magnitudes 6.5. And there was a strong one about 60 days afterwards in 2005. It was, I would say it was basically the Assam area, which had a magnitude of over 8. So the peak, let me say, the magnitudes of aftershocks after a very strong earthquake can be very significant. And I've shown previously that even a magnitude 5.5 aftershock could create in the near field very high accelerations. So what is important if a strong earthquake occurs? Seismicity may be high for days or weeks or even months or even longer, as we see here in this case. This is still after 2-3 months, there are still many earthquakes with magnitude in the range of 5 to 6 which occurred here. Okay, the important is, if a strong earthquake occurs, it's very likely that the seismicity is high after that earthquake. Okay, this is belongs to India in the Andaman Sea. This is a Kalpong rock fill dam. And you see, this is the only dam there in the Andaman Islands. And you see it gave here a crack, basically along the dam crest, which we have also seen from other dams. Okay, to repeat very quickly here, the seismic performance of concrete dams, I've shown that, but I show the similar slides because it is important to note that we do not have many evidences or observations of the behavior of dams which have experienced very strong ground shaking. I would mention here once more, you see here this leakage along this horizontal line. These horizontal lines are lift joints. The dam has been built in lifts of 2 meters. You see here some leakage. You see some leakage at different elevations, which indicate that water is seeping through the whole dam and that the seismic cracks basically develop differently from what I have discussed this morning, propagate through the whole dam body from upstream to downstream. But the water level was quite low, so the water is just seeping. The water pressure is small here at this elevation, so therefore the water is just percolating here through this crack. Okay, which shows here this crack along at the upstream face. This shows some crack here in this buttresses at the downstream face and here at the upstream face near an intake gate. Also, we have here rock falls is a problem because it easily can damage transmission towers if they are unprotected. It needs only a small slide in order to destroy these transmission towers. Also the structures in the premises of this dam, they are not designed for strong earthquakes. This is in Iran, if they are designed against the earthquakes. And also, therefore, during that 1990 earthquake, basically all structures, also here, villages further up, they were completely destroyed. We have a transformer, I've shown that before. We have a problem of ground displacement. I would like to repeat that also in the switchyard, in mountainous region, you have to excavate some part, and you have to fill. And on fill, on the ground shaking, you may experience ground displacement and also an increased seismic hazard. If you look in building codes, then fill is the worst soil type for the foundation of structures. So therefore, we have here, let me say, here in this area with fill, we have this main damage. We have plenty of rock falls in the mountains, and I think in the Himalayas, you have similar situation. I think during that earthquake, magnitude 7.5, it was reported, I think, about 10,000 rock falls. Okay, I don't know how they counted, but somebody referred to about 10,000 rock falls. Here's some impact, small impact rate of the rock. This is an Andes sphere. Okay, so some big boulders are also falling down. There are ground shaking affecting the structures and the control units, which is very essential. If this would be control units, for example, for spillway gates or for low-level outlets, then it could not be operable. Now, Sepideru Dam, which I've shown, it has been repaired and strengthened. Okay, because it would not comply, let me say, with the current seismic safety requirement. What has been observed here, this is a buttress of this buttress dam, and there have been some cracks developing, and these cracks basically developed along construction joints. We have here inclined. This is the head of a buttress, and this is the web. So this is a lift joint. So the cracks developed at the lift joint and along this construction joint. And here also one was in a diagonal direction. So therefore, for a strengthening, each block, which I've shown before, was, let me say here, each of these blocks, we have a width of 15 meters, we four blocks, about 20 blocks here, cracks going through all blocks here. Sorry. Here, rock anchors were provided in each of these blocks, 20 blocks, and see here 12 post-tensioned rock anchors provided with a total force of 100 meganewton. Okay, that is 10,000 tons. Okay, you see here, this is a cross-section of this dam. At this elevation, we see here the web and here the head of a buttress. So there are different anchors provided, most of them in the head and some also in the web. But if you look in the cross-section here, B, which is near the top, we have, okay, this is basically on the top, we have these rock anchors provided here. So with that, let me say the cracked areas, you could impose some additional stress. The 100 meganewton you provide maybe an additional vertical stress of about, it is not much because the cross-sectional area is big. You do not provide more than, let me say, in the order of 10 kilos per square centimeter is an additional force through these rock anchors. What we see here, the repair work being done by strengthening, they excavated on the crest, the anchor heads, which were placed here. Some drilling was being done for epoxy grouting, for water tightening of the dam. As I've shown, there was some leakage, and people found several other cracks in the dam during drilling. But of course, some of these cracks were also shrinkage cracks from the time of the construction. Not all were seismic cracks. The seismic cracks were basically those along the joint, the lift joints. Okay, you see here, after this excavation, these anchors have been installed here before stressing, and then afterwards they were cut here. Okay, so this is only during construction. The dam doesn't look like that now. This is just during a placement of these rock anchors. Okay, the repair of Koyna Gravity Dam. This Koyna earthquake from 1967, there are for strengthening different measures have been used. Also, anchors have been provided here. The damage is what I discussed this morning. It occurred at this kink. At this kink, you have a stress concentration. So therefore, if any crack develops, it develops at such weak locations. It propagates somewhere. Preferably, if it is built here at lift elevation, it preferably would propagate along lift elevations, as in the case of the Sefidruh Dam in Iran. So we have the anchor bars. Please, in your dam, it is important that you do not use such profiles. They are not good. Okay, this is a very critical. So therefore, this dam, okay, we see a small kink we have here is basically, I would say, it's not a problem. But this here is a very, quite a sharp kink, which, as you know, during construction of this dam, it was decided to increase the height of the dam, maybe at this elevation. So therefore, it was extended in this unusual way towards the dam crest. This is not a typical, this is actually a bad shape. It's not a good design. So therefore, after that earthquake, you see also the dam was strengthened besides the rock anchors. There was a buttress added at the downstream face. And up to this elevation, 1970, it was a massive. It covered the whole width of the block. But in the upper portion here, up, it covered, you see, 20 foot, 50 foot, 15 meters. Here it is about 6 meters. So here it is basically in the upper portion, it is a buttress. It's not a solid like in the lower portion, but you can see the shape now of this gravity dam is basically what we would expect from a gravity dam. That means a kind of a triangular shape. And here I must say, at this dam, the width is also about 14 meters, which would be like the width we usually select for very high dams in Switzerland, as discussed before. This would be good. But just to refer, usually we use for the downstream slope, we use a slope of about 0.8 to 1. Okay, this is 0.75 to 1. But this is for a vertical upstream face. Here we have a slightly inclined upstream face in the lower part, so we can have some small, slightly smaller value. If it would be vertical, the typical shape, the typical slope would be about 0.8. Okay, that is if Koyna. A few words once more about dams and faults and discontinuities. If you have some fissures in the dam foundations, they could be reactivated. by strong ground shaking, as in the case also of Cepidru Dam. The problem with these fissures is that water, if it can move in like that, you have full uplift pressure. You do not have dry joints. And I have said dry joints are very favorable, let me say, in order to limit the growth of cracks. And if you do a stability analysis here, if your water is splashing in, you would have to assume, if you have critical blocks in that area, you would have to assume full uplift developing, and the, let me say, the grout curtain will not contribute to any reduction of this pressure, of the uplift pressure. So it is undesirable to have some water coming in into the foundation gallery, as in that case. Okay, if you are in fault, on fault, I have shown that you have, here we have a vertical offset of about 9 meters, also some horizontal offset. You cannot build concrete structures on such faults. Okay, so that is very important. And I've shown you previously this project. I can maybe go quick. This here, once more, I've shown this Gilum Gilum project. It has here a rockfill dam. This is a main boundary thrust here, which passes by, which is capable of producing displacements also of several meters. So therefore, if it would be a concrete dam, it could not be designed across this fault zone. So if you do not account for that kind of movement in a foundation, you would end up at something like we have here. Basically, you would need here, in this fault part, you would have needed here an embankment dam. Because embankment dams, but it would also have been quite difficult, because the movement here, fault displacement, has been about 9 meters. So it would be also quite some challenge to design an embankment dam, basically a rockfill dam, which would be able to withstand movements of 9 meters. I would say this nobody has yet done. What we have done is 1.534 meters. Okay, with embankment dams, you know yourself from India, from a Abuja earthquake, where I think about 240 dams had to be strengthened after that earthquake. Most were small earth dams. As you can see, fortunately, the reservoirs were practically empty when it occurred in Republic Day, I think, in India, in January. So therefore, if you have damage to a dam where the reservoir is empty, it is not a safety problem, but it may become a safety problem in the monsoon period. So people here had to make sure to make sufficient repairs, especially of a spillway, in order not to create more damage when after or during the monsoon period. Okay, we see here we have large deformation. I've shown that also there was some brick structure on the dam crest here. It shows, brick structures are already very vulnerable to seismic actions, and we have here some significant displacements taking place, and of course, structures are subjected to some foundation displacements here. They will not be able to withstand that. Some of the cracks are quite large. In some movies, you will see some cracks being extremely deep, but usually these cracks are not very deep, because from soil mechanics we know if you look the stresses in the soil, if you have a horizontal soil, We have a vertical stress and we have a horizontal stress, which is a factor, actually this sinus phi, which is the friction angle of a soil, which is typically in the order for 30 degrees. It gives a value of 0.5. So if you would have a vertical stress of 1 megapascal, you have a horizontal stress of 0.5 megapascal, and the deeper you go, the higher the horizontal stress comes. So therefore, at some depth in the range of about 1.5 or 2 meters or so, the horizontal stress is large enough to close this crack. The crack will not propagate here unless this crack may be a failure of a whole sliding mass. But if you have just a crack in the soil, it is not really very deep. It will not just, kill people if they fall into this crack. They are not deep. Okay, I said already, if you have liquefaction, if you have old types of dams, existing dams which were built here in the 1920s in the US, was built with this hydraulic fill dam. They are actually vulnerable to liquefaction. This hydraulic fill, I must say, in Western countries, it has not really been built widely, except in the 1920s, 1930s. But there are small dams, very small dams, 5 meters high, 10 meters high, which are founded not on the rock, but on maybe sandy soil, which may be liquefiable, which are maybe vulnerable then to this kind of damage. We have been involved in some big dams, I think in the Riga Dam in Latvia. There were the side dams at a length, I think about 17 kilometers, built by during the time of the Soviet Union, and they used this hydraulic field. It, from a seismic point of view, it's not a good selection, but there in the Baltic states, the seismic hazard has been very, very small. Okay, this is again from this Sekiru dam. Also, this is from Japan, showing this a slide that actually at the upstream phase on the seismic actions, it is possible that you have, a sliding as you assume, for example, in the static design of embankment dams, where you check the slope stability. Of course, usually people check the slope stability with a failure surface through the crest, but on the seismic actions, most of the failures are actually shallow failures, and for well-constructed dams, and the deep-seated failures are more the exception for poorly built dams. Okay, just to say a few words about observed earthquake performance of fill dams. I would say modern well-built embankment dams have performed well during earthquake, during strong earthquakes. Compacted clay dams have also performed well. Rock fill and concrete based rock fill dams have also performed well. However, only very few of these dams have been exposed to strong ground shaking. The problem is basically with insufficiently compacted sand or silty dams and tailings and hydraulic fill dams, which have performed poorly. So if you look in the re-evaluation, seismic re-evaluation of dams, and if you want to, select some candidates which have to be looked at first, you may look at such kind of dams here. Now, I mentioned already, if we do the seismic safety evaluation of existing dams, You must use the seismic design and safety criteria for large dams, which I have discussed in workshop number two. The performance criteria, which are the safety criteria. In the old days, the performance criteria were allowable stresses and stability factors against the sliding and overturning in the case of concrete dams. But today, the performance criteria are more general and they are more comprehensive than in the past. First, of course, this is like in the past, the dam must be safe and it must be able to retain the reservoir in order to protect the people from a catastrophic release of water. Okay, so this is the main objective. So the dam must be safe. And I must say, since the 1930s, the emphasis was basically all on that. But today, we have to go beyond that. We must be able to control the reservoir after a strong earthquake. As shown, I must say, in China, in Menchuan earthquake, as a dam could be overtopped and destroyed if the inflowing water into the reservoir cannot be released through the damaged spillways or low-level outlets. Okay, if your flood discharge openings are blocked and the water is coming in into the reservoir, it is clear the water level will raise and raise and raise, and after some hours or days after the earthquake, the dam will be overtopped. And we know overtopping is of main concern of fill dams, of embankment dams. Concrete dams may be overtopped to some extent, but they are much less. They are not vulnerable to, progressive erosion like rock fill dams or embankment dams. But if they are small dams, they may be subjected, if they have overtopping of a few meters, for example, if it is a small dam, only 10 meters high, which is overtopped by 2 or 3 meters, in this case, the static sliding stability due to this water load will no longer be okay. So you may have also a sliding failure of concrete dams. Okay. And it should be, which is something I would recommend, is it should be possible to lower the reservoir after an earthquake in order, number one, to repair works, like I've shown before, but then in Japan, where the reservoir level had to be lowered in order to repair that dam here. Okay, here. See, this year the reservoir level was probably here at the time of the earthquake, and in order to do this repair here, they removed this part and placed it newly. It is of course much easier to do this repair work if you can lower the reservoir. If the reservoir would stay here, which unfortunately happens, it will be quite difficult to do here a good quality repair work of this damaged dam. So therefore, to lower the reservoir is quite important. And number two, to lower the reservoir is useful for increasing the safety of a damaged dam, or when there are doubts about the safety of the dam. It is clear that villagers downstream of some dam, if they observe some cracks, okay, they do not know what's the importance of the cracks, and maybe some dam engineers are also not familiar, or some owners, let me say, are also not familiar, and it comes in the press, and politicians make pressure and say this dam is unsafe. How do you make the dam again safe? You can make the dam safe by lowering the reservoir. Okay. If you lower it by one third, as I said already previously, in the V-shaped valley, you can reduce the water load by half. Okay, I call seismic design criteria for seismic safety checks. Basically, you have to use the same criteria. I just want to refer to the top here for the dam safety, for the dam body and safety critical elements. Safety critical elements are a spillway. And if you talk about spillway, they are spillway systems. They also include control units, motors. They include emergency power supply and so on. And it's a system of low level outlets, which are easily gates or valves. And here it's also the whole system, which so that these gates and valves can be operated. Okay, again, to repeat, for these parts of a dam, we consider two levels of earthquakes. This is a state of the practice today. This is for the design. Operating basis earthquake, safety evaluation earthquake. And I've discussed already how we could obtain that by a deterministic or probabilistic seismic hazard analysis. I would like to say, for safety checks of existing dams, please keep that in mind. You only have to check for the safety evaluation earthquake. Let me say, your dam safety authorities or the government, they just want to know if the people living downstream of a dam are safe. So therefore, you have, for existing dams, you only have to ensure that the dam is safe for the safety evaluation earthquake. Because if it is safe for that, it will be safe for a smaller earthquake as well. Okay, please keep that in mind. But in some places, people also ask for OBE and so on. This is not necessary. Switzerland, for example, the government is only asking for that assessment. So for seismic safety evaluation of existing dams, you only consider the safety evaluation earthquake today. But for new dams, you consider all types of earthquakes. In workshop number two. Now, the safety critical elements, it is quite important. I think it could be considered as somehow new. Because up to now, people have only focused on the dam body. But in order to satisfy here, this performance criteria, in the old days, performance criteria were, as I said, were allowable stresses and stability safety factors. But today, you must be able to control the reservoir also after the earthquake. And this now, I must say, requires the proper functioning of the hydromechanical and electromechanical equipment of spillways, of gated spillways, and of low-level outlets. This year, I must say, it is desirable. There are too many dams, I must say, where it is not possible to lower the reservoir. If you cannot lower the reservoir, you have to accept these disadvantages. Repair works, and you cannot increase the safety in the case of safety problems. It is a problem. Okay. So now what are the safety critical elements which are very necessary after the earthquake, you know, to have the project safe? They are the spillway gates, and I mentioned they must be safe for the safety evaluation earthquake in some, let me say, design guidelines or manuals, even of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. It is not given the right. You know, it is just given from a viewpoint. It is enough when the gate is safe for the operating base earthquake. It is not okay. We really have to look here systematically into all safety aspects. Okay, so for the spillway, if you have gated spillway, we have to look at the whole system is working properly. You can have quite a lot of problems. So therefore, I would say the safest spillway which you can have is actually ungated spillway. If you have ungated spillway, you do not have these problems here. And you can sleep well even in the case of extreme floods and in the case of an earthquake. If the spillway is not severely, itself, the spillway structure is not severely damaged, but the weak points in gated spillways are very clearly the spillway gate. And we have, secondly, for low-level outlets, they must also be able to withstand the strongest earthquake, and it should be operable, as I said already, to help to control the water level in the reservoir or to lower the water level after the earthquake in order to do repair and to increase the safety of the dam. So it means if you have low level outlets, if your average inflow is 100 cubic meters per second, then the low level outlets must have let me say a capacity which is more than 100 cubic meters per second. Some people think the low level outlet is something like an environmental flow outlet with just a few cubic meters. With a few cubic meters, if you have an environmental flow of 10 cubic meters per second and an inflow of 100 cubic meters per second, you can never lower such a reservoir. Okay, so this gives also some idea about the capacity required for low-level outlets. So just to repeat here, the safety critical elements are used to control and lower the reservoir after strong earthquakes. Therefore, the same seismic design and safety criteria apply as for the dam body. People have not really realized, and it means these gates and walls are the main task of hydromechanical engineers. And the hydromechanical engineers must be told, because their key competence is normally not in the seismic safety, they must be told that their equipment has to withstand the strongest ground shaking, and the same for the electrical engineers. Electromechanical equipment must also resist the strongest ground shaking, and it must resist the strongest ground shaking at the location where it is installed. And I have shown in a previous slide that for a concrete gravity dam, for example, if you have an emergency power supply located or generator located on the crest there, at the crest, you may have an amplified ground motion of factors 5 to 7. If your ground motion is 0.5, it would have to resist a peak acceleration of 5 to 7 times larger. That means of 2.5 to 3.5 G. So therefore, this is a problem, and it is a problem also for spillways in concrete dams, in RCC dams. If you have crest spillways, usually for modern now RCC dams. You have crest spillways, and therefore these spillway gates, if it is gated, will be subjected to much stronger ground shaking than the dam body itself. So you will have an amplification of several factors. Please keep that in mind. Okay, now application of a seismic design criteria. It is quite important also to know, in the past, the seismic design criteria are only applied to the dam body. And it is important, it must include saddle dams. I have been involved in the Panama Canal is mainly made by a lake formed by a dam, but this lake has, I thought, 32 saddle dams. Okay, the Panama Canal, the old one, 100 years old, it has 32 saddle dams, and it is clear if some saddle dams, if they would fail, and if the water could be released, these dams must satisfy the same seismic safety criteria than the main dam body, the body of the main dam. So don't forget the saddle dams. Sometimes been in Ethiopia, where people used quite lower safety standards for saddle dams. Okay, if the saddle dams do not cause, loss of lives and do not cause damage, okay, we can, for small saddle dams, we can allow smaller safety standards. But where the reservoir could be released and people killed, saddle dams would have to satisfy the same safety criteria as the main one. Number two, safety critical elements. I mentioned already, it have to be designed for SE and OB if we do a design, but if we check, as I pointed out, for safety check, we only need the of existing dams, we need only the SE. It is enough. Okay, we also have to look into the stability of dam abutments, which is a big concern. I mentioned also for arch dams, because arch dams are very vulnerable to foundation movements. So we have to look into this part. And number four, we have to look in the reservoir slopes. You can have rock slides or landslides, which may block intakes of the spillway or of the low-level outlets if they occur just at the dam site. Or they may create large impulse waves in the reservoir, which may overtop the dam. So basically, the safety evaluation earthquake today, we have to look at them in the safety in a more comprehensive way. I would say this is old. In the 1930s, until recently, most existing dams have only looked into that. But today, if we really want to have this critical assessment and the comprehensive safety assessment, we must look into this. We must look into this feature. You have your, I think in February, you have this big incident in Chamoli in Uttarakhand, where a big ice and rock propagated along some valley and washed away some hydropower plants, runoff river power plants, which were under construction. I must say, today we would have to look into that, not only the reservoir slopes, like in the case of Chamoli, we would have to look also even in the catchment area, if there are such critical landslides could be created. I would say, okay, this case in Chamoli is an exception, which we do not really have in most parts of the world, but in the Himalayas, it seems you have such events and glacier lake outburst events and so on. You have to take them into account, and they have to be checked for the strongest earthquake. Okay, just to remind you what is a good news on earthquake performance of dams. Basically, from the modern dams, only one embankment dams have failed with the loss of lives of 8 people killed during the Tohoku earthquake. And for concrete dams, up to now, no concrete dam has failed, which caused loss of lives or where the reservoir was released in a catastrophic way. This is a very good news. Less good news is, I have mentioned also, is tailings dams. Several tailings dams failed during strong earthquake in Chile, which caused quite a large number of loss of lives. The problem with tailings dams is that the owners of tailings dams, okay, they are mining companies mainly, their core business is not dam construction. So therefore, they feel this is just something necessary for environmental protection, but it is not that simple. So therefore, some people like to use lower safety standards for tailings dams than for water dams. This is actually is very risky and it is wrong. Now, I got also some argumentation from people, from senior people even, who, based on this excellent seismic performance of water storage dams, they feel that we can lower the safety standards. Because we have only one dam up to now failed and no concrete dams. But the opposite is true. It shows, if you have this very small number of failures, it shows that the seismic safety standards which we are using today are adequate. They are very successful. They should not be reduced. Also, some other people, as I said, it does not mean that these dams are overdesigned and that the seismic safety standards can be lowered, as some people may conclude. And I think you have the same in India, not only in India. I know people, especially also in Germany, and older engineers, they say, for example, the dam has been there for 100 years. So therefore, he has experienced everything. So therefore, it is already safe. Why should we increase the safety factors? Okay, it is a very dangerous conclusion. I was, let me say, in Bohol, is an island in the Philippines, where the Spanish built quite a number 400 years ago, 300, 400 years ago, quite a large number of large churches on this island, and there was a strong earthquake, I think it was about 7.3, and there was no earthquake on this island for 500 years. So people thought, yeah, well, these churches, they are really well built, they have survived 200-300 years, and so on, so they are absolutely safe. But when this earthquake occurred, I think it was about 6 years ago, I was went there, and I have seen these churches were built 300-400 years ago, they were completely destroyed. So don't get the wrong impression if you have one dam which has been there for 100 years, but if no strong earthquakes and so on has occurred, it doesn't mean that it has experienced everything and that it is strong. It is a completely wrong conclusion. It is very dangerous. And I have seen it myself there in the Philippines. People have this perception that this then these churches were absolutely safe, but actually they were extremely weak. Okay, now just to say a few words about the main steps for seismic safety evaluation of fill dams. This is the normal procedure, how you would go. You would first have to determine the seismic failure modes of the dam. The seismic failure modes of embankment dam, fill dams are overtopping and internal erosion, which are applicable to all embankment dams, let me say. Now a second, so you would have to check for these failure modes if you do safety evaluation. Number two, then you have to assess the ground shaking hazard. So that means the main parameters of the safety evaluation earthquake ground motion. That is basically the response spectrum, acceleration response spectra, and acceleration time histories. And then in the analysis you have to make for this embankment materials, consists of different material zones. You have to make assumptions based on standard tests, for example, or based on values published in the literature of similar materials. You have to estimate the dynamic material properties, which are somehow different from the static ones. Then, in the next step, you would have to do the dynamic analysis. We think the state of practice today for embankment dams is still a 2D analysis of a dam foundation system. And I would say the method which has been in use in practice is was developed basically 50 years ago. This method is still being used, equivalent linear method. In the literature, you will find also many published data on shear strain dependent, shear moduli, and damping ratios of different materials. Then you would have to make an assessment, I must say it's also more or less qualitative, of the buildup of a pore pressure. We do not talk about liquefaction. There are some classifications of different materials. I said already this hydraulic fill dams, there would be a pore pressure buildup, but also in other types of dams, you may have some buildup of pore pressure, which does not reach a value of liquefaction, but which may increase the pore pressure by, let me say, a few percent. But if a pore pressure goes up a few percent, it has some effect on the shear strength. If this is like the uplift, the dynamic uplift pressure from a concrete dam, if it would be increased dynamically, it will reduce the sliding stability. Then the next step you would have, based on the dynamic analysis, you would have to do a permanent displacement analysis of potential sliding masses using, for example, the Newmark sliding block analysis. This is the simplest method for such for estimating the inelastic deformations. In the meantime, there are more sophisticated methods, but the Newmark method, I would say, is widely used, and I think, in my opinion, it is a suitable method. It is a suitable model, let me say, to check the possible deformations which could be expected during a strong earthquake. Then you would, during ground shaking, you will also have a compaction of the embankment materials. Therefore, based on observations, there are some empirical relations where the settlement is given as, depending on the earthquake excitation, as a percentage of the dam height. So these are empirical relations, but one can also do it in the dynamic analysis. But in the practice, it would be easier to do it with some empirical relations. Then, based on the settlement, you can estimate the freeboard reduction during that earthquake. We were involved in one case in the Philippines, Ambuclao Dam, which settled 2.8 meters actually during an earthquake in 1990. Okay, and then we would have to do an assessment of the internal erosion hazard by looking into the damage to a fine sand filter or the offset of this fine sand filter. If a sliding surface is passing through that sand filter, or we would have to look into other waterproofing element membranes, which today are, for example, deep in today are asphalt core rock fill dams, which are very thin membranes with a thickness of, let me say, 1 meter or less. And then the seismic safety assessment is done based on the calculated deformations. So therefore, in order to be safe here, you must ensure that your freeboard, you still have freeboard after the earthquake, and that your filter, I would say today most dams have a filter, some others, those which do not have a filter are actually vulnerable, are problematic. So you would check based on this offset if the filter is still working after the earthquake. So that is basically the main steps, and it involves different types of analysis. So you would have to follow kind of this template. Now, if you do for concrete dams, again, here the seismic failure modes are different than those obtained for embankment dams. On the topic is also plays a role, but these dams do not settle, concrete dams do not settle, they will just deform 1 or 2 millimeters, just very small, but it will be stability, global stability, maybe sliding failure, or it could be, I must say, failure of the concrete blocks near the dam crest. As I've shown already, near the dam crest, we have great amplification of the ground motion. So the failure mode includes the dynamic stabilities of concrete blocks separated by joints and by lift joints, for example. Again, here the ground shaking hazard has to be determined. Again, the dynamic material properties of mass concrete and foundation rock have to be estimated. The main material properties for concrete dam, I must say, which is still somehow it's not the secret, but the people are just using some values, is the damping ratio. If you do a dynamic analysis of the concrete dam, basically arch dams, the damping ratio is very small, is maybe only 2-3%. You will have large amplification. But in some other parts, people are using high damping ratios. Also, if you look in US Army Corps of Engineer manuals, they give some high damping values. In Switzerland, we do not allow more than 5%.
Okay.
Now, if we have monolithic dams, like an arch dam, we also would have to model in the finite element model the block joints, which are grouted in the arch dams, and we would have to model the dam foundation contact joint. When we do a dynamic analysis, which is a 2D or 3D dam reservoir foundation system, and when we are doing dynamic stability analysis of concrete blocks, separated by joints and cracks. The critical blocks are the Vadam crest. Please don't forget that. In up to now, everybody looked into the global stability of a dam, of a gravity dam, with the sliding surface at the foundation level. But the critical ones are actually near the dam crest, and people have not looked into that. Okay, and then one would have also to look into the dynamic stability of the abutments, and also in the dynamic stability, of course, of the reservoirs. But this is for the reservoirs the same as for embankment dams. So, but the abutment stability is of main concern for arch dams. And then the seismic safety assessment is based basically also on calculated deformations. With rock fill dams, I would like to come back. I would draw your attention. I would say at this time we have done a lot of analysis for one dam in Iran. We had a lot of talk with leading, let me say, embankment dam experts. We came to the conclusion that due to the limitations of the software, 3D software, which is still there, and also to the limitations of, let me say, centrifuges with the combined shaking table. We have done such tests in Korea, for example, or then in the Philippines. It could not be reliable results could not be obtained. So because of these limitations, we think even in narrow canyons, and you may recall, for example, Terry Dam. Terry Dam is in a narrow valley. If you come to this narrow valley, some people would argue you have to do a 3D analysis. And I myself, as a committee chairman, I must say about 20 years ago, when the ICOL president, Mr. Varma from India, I think he was then asked by the president of India about the safety of Terry Dam. And there were some people, of course, opposing Terry Dams. And when they said they insisted on, I must say, for Terry Dam, different levels of seismic analysis were already carried out during the whole project life. And at the end, they were saying it must be a 3D analysis. And they asked me then, okay, can I give a certification that the 2D analysis is okay? Of course, we are not doing that. But I just want to say that the people for some dams, they come to a 3D analysis. You can make it incredibly expensive, and when you, if you do really inelastic behavior, you may not be able really to calculate it properly. Okay, of course, those who oppose that project, they would like that engineers would have big difficulties in doing extremely complicated analysis, which are not the state of practice. But our conclusion is based on really a lot of analysis which we have done, that at this time you use a two-dimensional model, even in a 2D-dimensional model of the highest cross-section, even in dams in narrow canyon. Of course, if you do a 2D analysis, plane strain analysis, it means that the dam is basically infinitely long, but you will get deformations from a 2D analysis which are larger than those in a 3D analysis. So if you design the dam or check the safety based on a two-dimensional model, you are on the safe side. Okay, this is a point which is quite some discussion, and you may have similar questions in future with your project. But I would say at this time, the state of practice is 2D. Also in the textbooks, everybody writes, it is a 3D narrow canyon. Well, it is 3D, but we do not really have a capability to make fully use. If you do a 3D analysis, I think you could, your results would be more realistic and they would be less conservative than those of a 2D analysis. So it is quite an important issue. Now, tailings dams, I just mentioned it, tailings dams which are vulnerable should actually satisfy the same design and safety criteria as water storage dams. Moreover, okay, we are also involved in nuclear waste disposal. Today in Europe, some people, I think it's stupid, people talk about 1 million years. Who can prove that something is 1 million years? Nobody can prove that. And therefore, I would say there is no progress in the storage of nuclear waste. Because no more, but people have been increasing the lifespan of the storage from 10,000 years to 100,000 years, and the last one I have seen is a 1 million year. It is simply, I would say, it is not possible. I would say it could be possible for some, let me say, effects from a natural environment. But in 1 million year, you know, if you have some at the depth of 500 meters, you have some storage. There will be some people after 50 or 100 years who would like to know what is exactly there and will do some drilling and so on. And they, you know, this is far away from 1 million years. So there will be the risk, I would say, man-made risk, which cannot be calculated in the case of this nuclear storage facility. But for the tailings dam, they must also store this tailings even longer than nuclear. Basically, they must store it forever. And if you store something forever, if it is hazardous material, okay, the safety factors or the safety requirements are actually even stricter than those for water dams. Okay, now seismic rehabilitation of existing dams. If we do a seismic safety evaluation, you may come to a conclusion that your dams may have need some kind of rehabilitation. So therefore, in the seismic safety evaluation, basically you have in the first step, you have to do this. You have really to check the seismic safety of all your dams. And if you have 5,200 dams in India, well, okay, then you check these 5,200 dams. But India is a very big country. You have 200 dams in Switzerland. It's 25 times less than in India. But our population is 160 times less than in India. So therefore, and we have been able to do it. So I would say in India, you should also be able to do that for all dams. Now, just some results. Some 25 years ago or 20 years ago, 1,200 dams were checked in California. It was done there. So therefore in India, it can be done. And in China, it can also be done. Even if there are 50,000 dams, it should be done. Of course, you would have to make some priority. If you have large numbers, there are certain dams which are more critical than others, depending also on the seismic hazard. But based on that review, about 10% have shown dams to have some deficiency and which needed some upgrading, seismic upgrading. This is in California, is in a zone of high seismicity. I thought most of your dams are in Maharashtra, which is not really a seismic area. I would assume that in India, you would also need some percentage of dams, of your 5,000 dams, which need some improvements. And let me say, the review in Switzerland, which was completed about 6-7 years ago, it has shown that the dams which needed seismic upgrading were dams which had already other deficiencies, other safety deficiencies, okay, which would have to be upgraded anyway. I think in India you also have, you have these strict programs and so on. So you, you also are looking into the improvement of the safety, not only the general safety, and this includes the seismic safety of several, I think 700 dams is in a phase two. Okay, what can be done if we see that the seismic safety is not adequate? I mentioned already, if you want to increase the seismic safety of a dam in a short term, the only thing which you can do is to impose temporary storage restrictions, and that means lowering of a reservoir. I mentioned if you lower the reservoir in most valleys by 30%, your water load reduces by 50%, so your dam becomes becomes safer. It is clear. So on short term, basically, you can only reduce the water load. And of course, if you then have a failure, the consequences of a failure will also be reduced very substantially, not only the loads on the dam. Okay. So lowering of a reservoir is the number one risk reduction measure which dam owner can take. But of course, the dam owners may do not like that. They need a reservoir for all kinds of purposes, electricity production, for water supply, for irrigation, and so on. Okay, so on one third of the cases, they impose this restriction on the water level. Then about the same for embankment dams and also for buffers, for concrete dams, to add slopes, or to add, sorry, for concrete dams, to add buffers, and for embankment dams, to flatten slopes. For example, you increase the freeboard if you have this hazard of, let me say, overtopping from impulse waves. There may be necessary, some 20 cases, it was necessary to do some outlet works rehabilitation. And there were some cases where permanent storage restrictions were imposed. That means basically almost decommissioning. If the dam is really unsafe and it is economically no longer feasible to repair that dam, basically it is decommissioning. And there are some foundation and or embankment materials removed and replaced, maybe wells which are susceptible to pore pressure buildup, liquefaction. Okay, these are more than 116 because some dams required several of these measures, improvements. Okay, but it shows, gives you some, I think it's a good statistics in my opinion, to show that some, there is some need to do some improvement. And in Switzerland, where we have completed that with more than 10 years, 15 years delay compared to California, it has shown that dams which had already a safety problems, and there are in India, I'm sure you have quite a few dams which have some safety problems. We also have this safety problems with some of our dams. So therefore, these dams are the number one candidates also for seismic strengthening. Please do not forget that. So I would say Terry Dam, in my opinion, is a very well-built dam, which will not be one which need repair, but maybe some old masonry dams built by the British 100 years ago and so on. They may have to be looked at carefully. Okay, I have shown this case once more, seismic rehabilitation. The seismic rehabilitation is not only the dam body, but it includes also the safety critical elements. And this is this Wakamura gravity dam built in the 1950s in New Zealand. And we see you have two dams, concrete dam, gravity dam, and we have here an embankment dam. If you have, you could say this is like a saddle dam. If we have, if we have this combined dams, let me say the safety criteria are actually more strict for the embankment dams than for the concrete dams. For example, if you look into flood overtopping of these concrete dams, it's not a big, it's undesired, but would not be a catastrophe. But if the water level would increase, we would have overtopping of this embankment dam, which may cause progressive erosion and which eventually may release the whole reservoir. If you have that, therefore, this would be the critical element. So here it turned out flood release opening is this spillway. You see the spillway structure. This is the spillway outlet here. And it was also designed with a pseudostatic method. And as I said, following the guidelines which I have given there before, we have to do a reassessment of the seismic hazard, take into account the dynamics of the dam. That means this gate structure here for lifting this spillway gate are on the dam crest, and I mentioned on the dam crest, gravity dam, okay, this here near the abutments. We may have amplification factors of 3, 4, 5. So the earthquake action on this level here, where this structure is supported, is maybe 4 or 5 times larger than on the rock surface. Also, the seismic hazard, the seismic coefficient of 0.1 is outdated. People doing seismic hazard analysis and coming up with much higher accelerations, let me say 0.4 G. For example, what was the result in the design was an equivalent pseudostatic acceleration of 0.1 G was used then by this civil engineers and hydromechanical engineers, but in the rehabilitated project, I've shown this slide already once, it turned out that the acceleration we considered at the support here on the dam crest is actually 1.8 G, a factor of 20. So it had to be strengthened substantially, as you can see, these flanges which have been added here. It looks quite different from the original one, which consisted just of this shear wall. Now here we have this huge flanges attached that it can withstand this ground shaking. So if we do a rehabilitation of some dams, let me say, if somebody says, okay, the peak ground acceleration is 10% larger than originally assumed, and so on, this is not really a critical case. Critical cases are, are many factors. It's not 10% on that. It's, you can forget. If somebody says the peak ground acceleration increased by 10-20%, if you use this value, these structures will not fail because of that, but they will be a problem if we have, okay, this is an extreme case, if you have these big differences. Now that is what we get today. So if you have dams, for example, central crest spillways also, which are on top of the dam, Maybe I should. Okay, if you have a central crest spillway here in the modern RCC dams, basically you incorporate the spillway directly in the dam body. And if you have gates, these gates would have to be designed for accelerations, which are 4 or 5 times larger than the acceleration acting on the rock surface. And this gives some limitations of dams with central crest spillway. And you know, in India, in the Himalayas, with your huge floods, your floods are really big. In Switzerland, we have only a fraction of your floods you experience during the monsoon season. So therefore, most of your dams basically consist of a spillway structure in relatively narrow valleys. And then these gates here, if you have a gated structure, will be subjected to very strong ground shaking. So this has to be checked. So what are seismic strengthening? This is if the shear strength, this is a multiple arch dam. Okay, it's an existing dam, no, but this may be under protection, protected structure, probably nobody built these dams today, but it was built 100 years ago there, or yes, about 100 years ago. Multiple arch dams, very thin, and here shear force is transferred by this artificial abutment, by this web. Turned out that it is not enough, and I said already that arch dams are quite vulnerable to some movements of the abutment. If it would slide here, it would create a lot of cracks in this thin arch dam, which is, from today's point of view, is already much too thin. So you see here, they added a lot of RCC. RCC means roller compacted concrete in our sense. So they put in here a lot of RCC to increase the shear resistance, shear strength, or sheer sliding safety of these abutments. Here, this is a dam in Switzerland. I mentioned already, in Switzerland, our problem has been with dams which had already a safety problem, or you know, at some time in the, I would say, 1960s, 1970s, or even 1950s, people, every dam engineer was keen in building arch dams, even at locations which are not suitable. For example, here in Switzerland, they built an arch dam in this wide valley. It is not too clever to do that. Today, we would better build here a gravity dam here, if you build a concrete dam, but not this known aspect ratio of crest length dam height of a factor of 7. So it turned out, also from a construction, there was already some problem, but then dynamically it was found that this dam is too soft, the wide valley, the arch action is an arch dam. If you have such a wide valley, it covers almost no load. In the previous case, I have shown in the top part, most of the water load is carried by arch action. But once you have this wide valley, your arch action becomes very small, and most of the load is carried by these cantilevers. So it turned out to improve the seismic safety also of the dam. It was necessary to modify these abutments. See, these are concrete masses which have been added at the downstream part near the left and right abutment. Quite massive, even thicker than the original dam. It has been anchored here in some parts in the foundation rock. So by doing that here, basically, the effect is like the shape of your valley becoming from wide to relatively narrow, and therefore the dynamic properties, boat shapes, and the corresponding maximum dynamic deflections and the eigenfrequencies are changed, so your dynamic response improved quite a bit. Okay, so how does it look like when I was there recently? Well, 3 years ago, you see this dam. Of course, it looks nice, but here we have marked it in the red, that you can see because the color is quite similar. This is this part which is, has been added on the right abutment. If you look here, it is this part here. Yeah, because the color of the concrete looks almost the same, but it has been repaired a few years back now, but it's almost 10 years back. So this here is the added concrete, and here on the left bank abutment, you have done the same, but I could not take a whole picture. Okay, so therefore in India, I would say if you do rehabilitation, you would have to look in the first instance also at some critical structures here. You see here a detail in the dam is called Lake Dul. This dam you may have seen because on this lake, I think, okay, today everybody talks about climate change and so on, global warming. So therefore, in this project, people have installed in a reservoir a floating photovoltaic plant. Of course, it is for promotion of this company, and worldwide people think that is a good idea. I don't think it's a, it doesn't solve the global warming problem, but it is now just a hype. People use that in this project, but here you see this is on the left abutment. The transition, of course, is not smooth, that the thickness here increases not just from a thickness of zero to maximum. Where it ends, we have an offset here, and that is what I'm showing here. Okay, that is the end of this abutment strengthening, which you can see here. Okay, so this dam is now back in operation, and if somebody is interested in floating photovoltaics, this has been greatly promoted, basically for this worldwide, I must say, on this project. Also, I feel, people are trying to do everything. These days it is not, the benefits is limited, but to have, it is about close to 2,000 meters elevation, and 2,000 meter elevation, of course, the radiation, solar radiation is larger than at sea level, it is clear, because the atmosphere, a lot of radiation is basically absorbed. So at higher elevation, you should have a higher efficiency if the sun intensity is the same. But in Switzerland, we are north of India. Okay, with embankment dams, what kind of strengthening has been done? Increasing the freeboard by tightening to add some buttresses here, some additional parts at the downstream phase, also some buttresses in the upstream phase. If you have some more deep-seated failure, okay, here we needed some additional drainage zone. It is also, as I said, if you have some impulse waves, you increase the freeboard, but you also, if overtopping, to increase the overtopping resistance can also be achieved by widening the crest. If you have a very wide crest, some waves which may overtop may somehow break and is much less critical. And there are some cases where some improvements in the soil is provided if you are have a soil foundation or highly weathered rock. And you see here, this is how this is in California, how it looks like. This dam is the rehabilitated dam, putting also some berms here. We have the downstream toll. And here, not only what I've shown you in this year, which is the same dam, where they did this kind of strengthening here, improvement. This is in the dam body, but of course they also did improvements here in the outlet works, as shown here. But each case is different, so we cannot really say which is better. Maybe here I can show here, which is a spillway. Ungated spillways, yes. Many of the Swiss dams have ungated spillways, but our, let me say, flood, maximum flood or safety flood or PMF or whatever we call it, is only a fraction of the floods you are experiencing in the in the foothills of the in Malaya. If we do the seismic safety upgrading, of course, we should look also in a comprehensive way. We should not only look in the structural safety, we also have to do again safety monitoring. Should be updated in strengthened dam. Maybe the rule curve may change, and also there may be some modifications in the emergency planning. I would just like to say emergency planning is also something which we would recommend strongly in India, which you should do it. Okay. Now, for the analysis, just to mention briefly, we do for the operating basis earthquake in a concrete dam where we say we should have no cracks. And if you have no cracks, basically we specify allowed stresses. If no cracks means that the maximum tensile stress should be less than the dynamic tensile strength of mass concrete. So we do a dynamic 3D analysis, and those who like to do analysis, we can do it extremely difficult. Looking into radiation damping in the foundation, if this is a mass foundation, looking into radiation damping into the reservoir, looking into wave absorption at the interface with the reservoir, and looking into non-uniform ground motion and so on, depending on the topography. So we can do the analysis, I would say linear elastic analysis. People like to do that, and you can do it. People have been doing it for 40 years already, and I would say, yeah, I would say it's not that satisfactory, because you can do this model so detailed that you, as a consultant, you could spend years in doing this kind of analysis, finding all kind of parameters playing a role. I would say it is better to make some assumptions, I would say, and in our case, we make the assumption, the government specifies that you assume here incompressible behavior of the reservoir, and you assume that you have no mass in the foundation, so you have only what we call kinematic interaction effects, which make the input of the seismic motion very easy, and the effect of the reservoir can be modeled by an added mass, which is attached here to the the upstream phase for them. So that would be the analysis. So just, I must say, we should come more close to the end. Discussion of OB analysis of concrete dams would be a linear elastic analysis. For the seismic analysis of a dam reservoir foundation system, we make a number of assumptions. The basic assumptions, which are approved by the government. In our case, I said, if you do not make this assumption, you can spend years, I must say, in doing dynamic analysis, like people in the nuclear industry. Okay, we assume uniform ground motion, we assume incompressible behavior, water in the reservoir, and we assume master's foundation. And we specify that the damping ratio is less than 5% for high arch dams. Okay, and in addition, we specify that the dynamic tensile strength of mass concrete is less than 4 megapascal for ordinary mass concrete. For RCC, it may be 2 megapascal or less dynamic, depending on the, let me say, properties of this roller compacted concrete. Now, we have to keep in mind that the strength properties of lift joints, if you use ordinary concrete, are less than these values. You know, RCC roller compacted concrete dams are also built in lifts of about 30 to 35 centimeters. So we try to get good bond between this layer, but at elevations of about 1 meter, you have also cold joint, which could have lower strength properties. Now, also with the OBE analysis, if somebody really wants to do this analysis, if radiation damping in the reservoir and in the foundation are considered, then the dynamic OBE analysis will become very difficult. But it can be expected that the dynamic response is less than in the case of massless foundation and incompressible reservoir. So if you feel your stresses and so on are too big, then some people are very keen in taking account of mast foundation. I think a book by Chopra, he is discussing a lot of mast foundation because the higher radiation damping, it reduces the maximum stresses by a factor of 2 to 3, which is a lot. But the foundation rock is not really similar to what is used in most of these finite element analysis. Okay, I just want to say ICOLD recommends a return period of the operating basis earthquake of 145 years. Longer return periods may be specified if you like. I think it is not really a good idea in areas of high seismicity. Here I would like to show how you can manipulate basically the results of the dynamic analysis. The main factor controlling the dynamic response of a dam is a damping ratio. Here, what I show is a damping ratio of 2%. This is a high dam in Turkey. In reality, if you do in situ test, you would measure probably 2%. 2% damping, the maximum principal tensile stress here, which is only under seismic action, would be 36 megapascal. I just gave this as a reference. If you use 5% damping, this is a value which we allow in Switzerland. Maximum stress here would reduce almost by half, 20 megapascal, but some people in U.S. Army Corps of Engineers and some other engineers, they specify high damping, 12% or 15%. If you do that, you get 13 megapascal. You can see by increasing the damping from measured ones to hypothetical ones with radiation damping, like in a book by Chopra, which I mentioned, you can reduce the maximum stress by factor of 3. So if you review some results of dynamic analysis, you really have to look into what kind of damping ratio has been used. If somebody uses a high damping ratio, I think he is trying to manipulate somehow, or he wants to achieve low stresses. Now, for the safety evaluation earthquake, you may use a simpler model than the model which is shown here. I will discuss it then tomorrow. We assume, for example, that we have already a crack. Here, the crack existed already due to alkali aggregate reaction. For example, water is here. And if we assume it's ground shaking occurring, once your dam is cracked, I would say 99% of the deformations of dam are due to deformations of this crack, not elastic deformation. In the OB, we are very keen in the elastic deformation of this dam body and foundation. But once we have cracks, all deformations are due to deformation along this crack. So if you have some ground shaking, it may open here upstream, it may open downstream, and at the end of the earthquake, and it may slide, may slip also. So at the end of the earthquake here, we may have in this case a sliding displacement of about 70 centimeters, which in this dam here in Switzerland was considered as okay. But of course, if during the earthquake you have this large displacement here, you will have leakage. The water level is here. You have leakage in this control gallery, and it will be necessary that you lower the reservoir, that you can lower the reservoir to below this damaged zone. Therefore, I said it is very useful to have a low level outlet. Okay, we also need some, sorry, I would just like to jump over that. Strong motion instruments should be also provided. And we should have emergency planning. We should have emergency action plans. And I must say, finally, if you want to save people, you need water alarm systems and people which would have to be evacuated in a case of failure would have to be informed before. Okay, this is the standard we are doing for all dams in Switzerland. We do this dam breach flood wave analysis, and the dam breach could be due to various reasons. It could be man-made due to military action, terrorism. It could be due to earthquake. But in our case, the main scenario which we look at, we look into the destruction of the dam due to military action. Okay, now to the conclusions here. The seismic hazard is a multi-hazard for most large dam projects. Ground shaking is the main hazard considered in all earthquake guidelines. The other seismic hazard, such as mass movements, may have been overlooked. So I would say, especially foothills of the Himalayas is very important. And you must now, this case of Chamoli, it was also for me quite interesting and surprising that even in the instability mass movement in the catchment has created basically a large destruction and large loss of life. What can we say in Chamoli? In such locations with large mass movements, I would say run-of-river power plants should not be built. They are unsafe, as has been shown. Okay, number two, the very popular pseudostatic analysis method and the use of seismic coefficients to represent the earthquake ground motion are outdated concepts and shall no longer be used for large dam projects. The results of pseudostatic analysis may actually be wrong, as I've shown. These facts have been known already since already before the 1971 San Fernando earthquake. Okay, we celebrated just the 50th anniversary. The conference will be in the next month. It's been postponed. We know that for a long time already, that it is not correct. But still today, people like to use the pseudostatic method, and I understand the Indian earthquake cold also allows the pseudostatic method. Also, it is not correct. Chinese cold allows that. Japanese cold allows that. It is not according to the current state. Number three, the characterization of a seismic hazard by seismic coefficient is not based on scientific principles. Okay, this is quite an important observation. We would say is a voodoo analysis. Number four, for the dynamic slope stability, which we have for the safety checks, we have to consider residual strength properties and not peak values. Because we can say after some shaking, the peak value has been exceeded, and then basically the residual strength properties have to be considered, and also some embankment material may build up some pore pressure. So therefore, some reduction on friction due to a pore pressure buildup may have to be taken into account. Number five, we can say dams are not really inherently safe against earthquakes, as many people may feel, like those which have not shown any damage for 100 years or more, because we have seen during the Wenchuan earthquake more than 1,500 dams and reservoirs were damaged. During the Butch earthquake, 240 dams had to be strengthened after the earthquake. So these dams are not just safe. If we have a strong earthquake, it shows there are problems. Fortunately, nobody was killed, but these dams needed substantial improvement. I would say the technology for building dams that can safely resist strong ground shaking is basically available. And finally, I would say emergency planning and installation of water alarm systems in the downstream region of large dams is a must. It is also a must, let me say, for earthquake, because earthquake can be a trigger for the catastrophic release of a reservoir. And finally, low-level outlets are required to control the reservoir after strong earthquake and to lower the reservoir for repair works, and also for, let me say, if you have to increase the safety of your dam in a short time, you must be able to lower the reservoir. So that is my presentation today. I would like to continue tomorrow. So if you have any questions, I'm happy actually to answer.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your detailed presentation. Now, may I request to the participants, if they have any questions, they may ask.
Maybe I have talked too much already, but it is, I hope everybody will get the PDF of my presentation, and okay, I've given some additional comments. My presentations are not overloaded with text, is my opinion. So, but anyway, I still hope that what I have shown or tried to explain, you can follow by looking at home, hopefully, into the presentations which I have distributed. So if you have any questions, particular questions, I must say also for the rehabilitation of dams, there is not only one solution. You know, each dam is a prototype, is unique. So therefore, let me say, we cannot just give general guidelines that this method of strengthening is required to all similar types of dams.
I guess you have explained everything in detail, so we don't have any questions right now.
That is fine.
That is absolutely fine. So I guess we should conclude the session for the day. See you all tomorrow at 1100 hours in the morning.
Yes. Okay.
Thank you. So, thank you, sir. Thank you to all the participants for their time. See you tomorrow. Goodbye.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Good evening. Okay. Goodbye.